friends, I'm Dr. Gracie Christie, and this is Conversations with Consequences, the radio show of the Catholic Association, where we are changing the culture one conversation at a time. You can listen to Conversations with Consequences on the EWTN Global Catholic Radio Network at 5 p.m. on Saturdays, and also on Sirius XM channel 130. If you want to listen to our show as a podcast, go directly to your favorite platform or to thecatholicassociation.org/podcasts. I'm your hostess, Dr. Gracie Christie. Today, Maureen Ferguson, she's my friend and colleague at the Catholic Association, will be joining me for the whole show. And at the bottom of the hour, we'll be talking to Congressman Dan Lipinski. He's a pro-life Democrat with a strong pro-life record, many terms in Congress. And he joins with a look at his own battle with the abortion giant Planned Parenthood, a battle that he lost, unfortunately, although he didn't lose his integrity, and all about the importance of bringing one's faith into the public square. What could be more essential and inspiring these days when all of us are being called to be brave and live our faith fully, right? But to start, we're being joined by legal scholar Helen Alvarez. She will give us a close look at an alarming Supreme Court decision this week. In June Medical, the court found that the state's law requiring abortion doctors to have admitting privileges in a nearby hospital actually posed substantial obstacles to a woman's access to abortion, instead of understanding that it brought significant benefits for the safety of women. As a physician, you can imagine how much this ruling infuriates me. We'll be talking to Helen Alvarez about it, and also about another case that just came through from the Supreme Court, this time a win in the case of Espinoza. Welcome to Conversations with Consequences, Helen.
Thank you. It's great to be here.
So, Helen, in the last couple of weeks, we've had good news and bad news coming out of the Supreme Court. I thought we'd start with the bad news and then move on to the happier news to end our segment. So, of course, with the bad news, I'm talking about the case of June Medical versus the state of Louisiana, in which the Supreme Court struck down a Louisiana state law which asked abortion providers, abortionists, to have admitting privileges in nearby hospitals. This was done to promote patient safety, and the law was struck down, I believe partly because it was a similar law to another case in which the law was also struck down out of Texas. So there was a precedent there.
It did, but it's a wee bit more complicated than that, of course. The plurality, the four liberal justices, struck the law down on the grounds that it was exactly like a law that they had struck down recently with Justice Kennedy on the court, a law from Texas that had required admitting privileges for doctors. And they said the Louisiana law was just like this prior law they had struck down. What was important about the plurality opinion was that they made up a new test, you know, what else is new in abortion jurisprudence, claiming that the court had the right to look again at the balance of benefits and burdens, how the law would benefit women's health, how the law would burden it, the same balance that the state legislature is actually constitutionally charged with looking at. The court said, no, 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 we're going to look at it too, and we're going to balance benefits and harms of the law. And we've determined that the law is more harmful and presents an obstacle to women getting an abortion than it is beneficial. But the fifth vote in June Medical came from Justice Roberts. And Justice Roberts voted to strike down the Louisiana law for a different reason. He said that the Supreme Court in this case, the Louisiana law, and the Texas case, had made up a new standard for judging abortion laws, and they had no right to make it up. So he's right about that. But then he said the reigning test is the test we had in the Casey decision from 1992, which just asks whether a law is a substantial obstacle to women getting abortion. He says this law is a substantial obstacle. Excuse me. And he votes to concur in the judgment with the plurality, giving them five votes, even though he says they used the wrong test. So they win in the liberal wing of the court, but going forward, the test that will be applied to abortion laws is not the test in this case, but the test that really came out of the Casey decision. So that's the little complicated part.
Huh. Helen, so just to give our listeners a little more of the backstory here, this Louisiana law nullified by the court, it was passed by a state representative, Katrina Jackson is her name. She's a Democrat, she's an African-American woman, and she saw that women in her state were being harmed by incompetent abortionists operating in what the record showed was shockingly unsanitary clinics. So her law simply required that abortion doctors have the same admitting privileges as doctors at other outpatient surgical clinics, because this is a means of sort of weeding out the incompetent or quack abortionists. One of the abortionists in the case was actually not even an OBGYN. I believe he was an ophthalmologist. So there's abundant evidence of abortion industry malpractice. There's a long line of notorious abortionists. So how is it, with a law that is seemingly so simple, how is it that Chief Justice Roberts just 4 years ago supported this similar Texas law? How could he perform such a backflip in this case?
Yes. So an answer and then a bridge to some more about what she said. The answer is that Justice Roberts said, I do not want to be a person who votes to upset prior decisions willy-nilly. He cited a doctrine known as stare decisis, the decision stands, and said, basically, whether, you know, for reasons of the reliability of the law or the stature of the court, it's not right for us to pass, to put out a decision and then basically to flip it. Going forward, the previous decision showed that laws like this were a substantial obstacle to women. Therefore, I'm going to vote for it. He said that the parties in the case had not asked for a reconsideration of the whole question about whether there is anything like a right to abortion. And of course, he could have spoken more about that, but didn't. And we know that he doesn't always rely on stare decisis. In fact, even in this term, he's said, you know, you can't respect certain kinds of decisions. They're just outright wrong. And ironically, he had dissented away from the holding in the Texas admitting privileges cases, saying that opinion was wrong in the first place. So we don't know whether he wants to strike a certain personal profile in the press, before the public, as a certain kind of justice. We don't know whether he believes deep down in his heart that stare decisis required this. For those who want to pursue more, Maureen, of what you were talking about, the best opinion to read is Gorsuch's. Gorsuch goes on in brilliant lengths, and by the way, Alito does too, but Gorsuch in particular highlights that there were literally dozens of health and ethical violations already known against these clinics, that the clinic's vetting procedure was absolutely a joke, and they actually had allowed radiologists and ophthalmologists to do abortions, that if a doctor basically hasn't lost his license anywhere, well, that's good for them, and they'll take him. And they had testimony, again, this horrid claim by, you know, abortion supporters that they represent women. The testimony was all on the side of women who literally were left, you know, bleeding, abandoned, perforated, etc., by abortionists who said, well, you know, we're done here. You know, my job is done. Go take care of yourself somewhere else, and had no intention of assisting those women with the problems the abortionists had caused. So we know that Louisiana had excellent reason for passing laws that basically, as you say, Maureen, put these doctors in the same positions of needing admitting privileges as doctors who do things like LASIK eye procedures and colonoscopies. I mean, it really is frankly ridiculous.
If you're just joining us, this is Conversations with Consequences, and we're listening to Professor of Law at Antonin Scalia Law School at George Mason University, Helen Alvary. Helen, one thing that struck me, and I'm sure it struck people who are more legally minded than I, is that the people bringing the suit were the abortion clinic owners. It was actually June Medical, the abortion clinic, bringing the suit. And what they were asking was to be allowed to have lower standards for treatment of the women than other surgical centers in the area. How come this didn't strike the justices more strongly?
I think the most significant thing you can say there is that when it comes to abortion, the rules are different. You know, abortion is like treated as like a super right. Erica Bakiaki wrote this great piece at SCOTUS Blog today where she said, can you imagine letting gun manufacturers bring lawsuits on behalf of people who want to own guns, right? Can you imagine that anybody would think, oh, no, we want to let them vindicate people's right to have guns? I mean, the left would be absolutely furious at this. But here you have, and all the, or almost all of the dissenters noted it, the idea that people who benefit financially from performing shoddy healthcare upon women are the people who can sue successfully to strike down laws intended to protect women's health. The conflict of interest here is absolutely huge. And, you know, the abortion industry has counted on this because they have the money and the legal power and the entire legal organizations devoted to representing basically corporate abortion, Planned Parenthood, these other clinics, whereas women would not likely sue for this. It's Planned Parenthood and other abortion clinics whose names are all over these cases suing to strike down laws protecting women and children.
It's so like the fox guarding the hen house and the fox claiming to speak for the hens, right? So can you expound a little bit more on the conflict of interest idea or more maybe even the issue of who should have standing in abortion cases like right. this? Because I think pro-lifers really were hoping that the court would speak to that issue, because why right. on earth should the abortion clinics have standing to sue for the rights of women?
Right. So first of all, standing is the following concept. It means that because the court can only hear cases and controversies, things where people's rights and interests are actually in conflict, then cases need to be brought by people who have suffered an actual injury to a legally recognized interest. The dissents in this case pointed out that the abortionists and the clinics have no legally recognized interest. They don't have a legal, a statutory, a constitutional right to do abortions under circumstances which are less than safe. They have no such right. They don't even have a right to do safe abortions. No one has a right to perform abortions. It's a matter of getting a license, demonstrating that you can medically do these, etc. So the state is well within its power to regulate them, and they have no right to say, like any other doctor, we have a right to do this thing without regulation. The majority in June Medical said, well, you know, we've allowed abortionists and abortion clinics to have standing in so many cases. It's been our practice, number one. Number two, really, they're vindicating the interests of third parties whose interests would be indirectly harmed if we had fewer doctors and clinics in Louisiana. So they use the indirect harm grounding. The question of what they had done in the past really should have no weight. But again, the dissents forcefully pointed out that indirect harm thing should be really rebutted completely, swept off the table by the fact that, as you better put it, Maureen, it's like allowing the foxes to speak for the hens and say, if you let us be less than ethical or less than safe, that'll be good for women.
Helen, I've read, following this disaster at June Medical at the Supreme Court, I've read that maybe the pro-life strategy of incrementally presenting more and more regulations on abortion, right, and trying to bring down the age of the pregnancy at which abortions can be performed and things like this, admitting privileges, that was a bad strategy, and that Justice Roberts' explanation, his opinion, presented another way forward and going straight to Roe and whether or not abortion should be legal at all. Do you think that might be true?
Yeah. You know, that's a great subject of conversation. It is certainly possible. It was noted, and I want to say it was noted by Thomas, Roberts, Gorsuch, and maybe also Alita, very specifically, that the parties did not ask us to revisit Roe or Casey. And Thomas penned an absolutely brilliant dissent that went through, that rehearsed a future opinion where it is held absolutely properly, in my opinion, but more than my opinion. I just think it's impossible to get around that the 14th Amendment could never be interpreted to create a federal constitutional right of abortion. This tells us we don't know for sure. Gorsuch did not express the opinion. Kavanaugh did not express the opinion in this case that the right of abortion definitively does not exist in the Constitution. So we don't know for sure we have five votes for that. But the way of going about this indirectly to make abortion, you know, to drive bad abortionists out of the system, drive bad clinics out, reduce the number of abortions, it didn't work here for very complicated reasons. On the other hand, some other incremental laws, among my favorite are the law of Indiana and I think at least another state that bans abortions on grounds of discrimination against those who are disabled or, you know, based on sex or race. I think that's a really wonderful question for the court and one that would push back against the number of abortions that are done guarding minorities and the poor and the disabled. But that may be correct, Grazia, and it may be interesting to see the movement tack on strategy.
So, Helen, if I understand you correctly, I hope you're giving us hope here. I'm wondering if you're just kind of saying this wasn't the best case for the pro-life side. And I saw you wrote a brilliant analysis of this case in the National Catholic Register. And there you were saying that this case didn't bring us any closer to overturning Roe, but yet it did not likely move us further away either. So is that what you mean by this?
Yes, it is what I mean. I think it's not good for us, and Justice Roberts could have been braver, bolder. He didn't have to vote stare decisis here. He could have said the whole edifice is built on sand, and that was a great disappointment. But the fact is that there wasn't a substantive reaffirmation that Casey is good law and a proper interpretation of the Constitution, only by Justice Roberts, that it's what we have now. And so I don't think this stands in our way for a strategy to overturn Roe. It is not going to be cited by anybody in the liberal wing of the court if Roe comes up for close evaluation.
Well, that's some good news, Helen. But in general, June was depressing for our side, for the side that is interested in the dignity of life. And that was right on the heels of Bostock, which was another big disappointment for people like us, people who understand these things and the way we understand them. But we did have some good news that just came out of the Supreme Court again, and that is the case of Espinoza. Maybe, Helen, as you're the expert, you can explain to our listeners what happened there and what it means.
This is so fascinating. My stomach was like churning with happiness when I was reading the case. Let me give a little background. In the mid to late 19th century, when Catholics, especially Irish, were emigrating to the U.S. and founding their own school systems, there was a gigantic anti-Catholic backlash. I mean, we were deemed to be dirty, unintellectual, anti-democratic, enthralled to a foreign figure, the Pope, versus being real Americans. There swept the United States a movement in favor of something called the Blaine Amendment, which almost became a federal constitutional amendment governing all the states, which banned state money from going to religious schools. And it almost passed at the federal level. It did not, but I think it passed up to 38 states, put it in their state constitutions. Well, for many years, states refused to allow any funding to go to religious schools, even, you know, with the voucher movement and the desire of many poorer Americans to get to either safer or better or just religious schools. These Blaine amendments were making that impossible. This case today, the Espinoza versus the Montana Revenue Commission or something, was a couple of Christian families who wanted to send their kids to Christian schools in Montana. A fund was created, and the state had agreed in a law that if people donated money to that fund, they got to pay less taxes. They got a tax credit. The state constitution, however, was deemed by the Montana Supreme Court to ban this arrangement. No, they said giving anybody a break on their taxes because money is being sent to a religious school is a violation of our state constitution. It's like directly putting money into the coffers of religious schools. Our state constitution says no. The question today before the court was, is that provision in the Montana constitution a violation of the free exercise clause of the federal constitution? Remember, the federal constitution has a supremacy clause. State constitution cannot give less free exercise than the federal constitution. The court held that Montana's constitutional Blaine Amendment violated the free exercise clause, which tends to indicate that every state that has it, and there's over 30, can no longer, if they decide to give money to private schools, can no longer refuse to let religious schools have them too. You know, it's an amazing result. We already know, because the Supreme Court has held, that it's okay for states to have programs whereby the independent private choices of parents, they decide to use certain money, usually voucher money, in order to send their kids to a religious school. Today's opinion wasn't about whether it's okay for states to do that. It's about whether states, if they give money to private institutions, can ban them from religious. So it was a great decision.
So the case was essentially a free exercise religious liberty case, but it has the effect of being just a monumental win for school choice advocates as well. And that translates into being a huge win for low-income families who are seeking a better future for their children. And it couldn't have come at a better time, because there's a debate in Congress about whether to allow any sort of tax scholarship, tax credit scholarships for school choice. And we're seeing the tragic closure of hundreds of Catholic schools across the nation, particularly in urban areas, that are closing due to the economic fallout from the pandemic. So I think there are many reasons to be excited about this case. And I'm reminded of something I read from Justice Sotomayor several years ago when her Catholic school in the Bronx closed. She told the New York Times, "You know how important those 8 years were for her in Catholic schools?" She said, "What it meant for all of our families, like my mother, who were dirt poor. She watched what happened to my cousins in public school and worried that if we went there, we might not get out. So she scrimped and saved. It was a road of opportunity for kids with no other alternative."
Wow.
So, I just love that quote from her. Anyway, so I'm curious, what are your thoughts on this angle of the court's decision, even though they weren't speaking directly to the school choice issue?
Well, interestingly, it was already in the record that those grants were going to people who had children who were disabled or poor. And there was a disproportionate amount going to minority families. So we know that that's how it was actually operating. In fact, second, an interesting little thing in this case, you know, after years of aid to religious school cases where they talked about religious schools as sort of like, you know, somewhat undemocratic, scary factories of conformity, producing children to follow a certain religion. Here we had Justice Alito saying a lot of people are afraid to send their kids to the public schools because their values are so antithetical to the parents. And isn't it wonderful that now people who have real school choice, like wealthy people, but are poor, are going to have the opportunity to go to religious schools too? So it was a very explicit point in his opinion.
And that is a very true point. I know a lot of people here in Miami, where I am, are recent immigrants, have lost everything in Venezuela, for instance, with socialism or any other situation in Latin America, and they're consigned, their children are trapped in public schools, and they are horrified at the ideologies that are being stuffed down their children's throats. And, you know, to recent immigrants, they are even more shocking than they are to us who have had time to get used to that, even if our children aren't necessarily at public school. So I think this is such good news. I hope that it translates rather quickly into some choice for poor children. Do you think that it will take some time for this decision to have real effects across the nation?
Well, I mean, just on the logic of it, I see two possible effects. One of them is that places that had felt constrained by their state's Blaine amendments will now begin to construct true school choice projects. The other is a more problematic, a little more complicated. The court didn't hold that states had to do voucher programs that included religious schools. It only said if you have one and it includes secular private schools, it has also to include religious ones. So some people will argue in states that are really anti-religious schools, or they're like all about public schools, everyone should go to public school, that should be all there is, those states will be less inclined to do voucher programs because they know if they do them for any private school, they also have to include religious schools. So it can go either way depending on the state's initial disposition regarding vouchers in the first place.
I saw on Twitter some very angry postings from people who, from the public school teachers unions. They're very upset about this. Although it sounds to me like there might be a silver lining for them if that is taken to mean that it's better not to have voucher programs at all.
Yeah, I really don't understand the public school union statements on this. I mean, all of us should be about what is good for the well-being of children. The idea that they are sort of dead set against private schools simply makes no sense. Schools have very good records.
And Maureen, tell us that statistic that you told President Trump on that call one day about how much money each Catholic student saves the taxpayer.
Well, Catholic schools educate children at about half the cost of public schools, but they have far better outcomes. They graduate about 99% of their students from high school. About 86% go on to four-year colleges. And if you think of the cost of the public schools absorbing the almost 2 million students that are currently in Catholic schools, if these Catholic schools are essentially going out of business due to the pandemic, it would cost the taxpayer actually about $24 billion a year to educate all these children that are currently being educated in Catholic schools.
Well, Maureen, here's hoping that taxpayers will see that private schools, especially parochial schools, are an amazing saving and start getting those voucher programs into place in each state so that this great news out of the Supreme Court will have effect right away. And thank you, Helen, for joining us. Thank you for being a friend of Conversations with Consequences and for being your very smart, very intellectual self on our show.
Thank you. Who wouldn't come on if you get compliments like this at any time? let's all say our prayers for the last couple of decisions that mattered to us a lot, the Little Sisters of the Poor and the California teachers cases about the school's right to hire and fire its own teachers.
You're so right. Yeah, we need to, all of us, pray really hard about this and hope that we get two more wins out of the Supreme Court. And thanks again, Helen.
Thank you. Bye-bye. Bye, Maureen.
Bye, Helen.
Coming up next on Conversations with Consequences, we'll be chatting with Democratic Congressman Dan Lipinski about his strong pro-life record and what it's like to carry the message of the gospel and the dignity of human life without compromise. Next on EWTN Radio. Welcome back to Conversations with Consequences, the weekly radio show of the Catholic Association, broadcasting every Saturday at 5 p.m. on EWTN Radio. We're so excited to welcome Congressman Dan Lipinski onto the show. He is serving the 3rd Congressional District in the state of Illinois. He's an 8-term Catholic pro-life congressman who, we are very sad to say, lost his primary recently to a pro-abortion challenger called Marie Newman after a total assault, no holds barred, by Planned Parenthood. Welcome to the show, Congressman.
That's good to be with you.
Congressman, you don't remember me, I don't think, but we've met a couple times at the March for Life in D.C. We've met back in the media tent, and I was always happy to see a pro-life Democrat in the mix. Very happy. I thought it's wonderful to have people from every side of the aisle, every kind of person, supporting an idea that is just human. It's not a political idea. It's a humane idea that all lives are valuable and they should all be respected and their dignity preserved. So thank you. Thank you for doing that from your side and from your perspective.
Well, I've always thought it was very important for the pro-life movement to have people in both parties, both Republicans and Democrats, because I think it's an issue for any movement. If it becomes a one-party movement, it's much easier for that party to take that issue for granted. And I think that that is why the pro-abortion side spent a lot of money to try to get me out of Congress as a Democratic representative. They spent about $3 million in 2018 and nearly won, and they repeated and spent at least that much earlier this year, and I was narrowly defeated. But, you know, I tell you, I'm proud to have stood up for being pro-life. A lot of people have immediately reached out to me and thanked me. I think this is a loss for the pro-life movement, but I'm going to continue on doing what I can my last 6 months in office, and then after I leave office, to continuing to promote a culture of life.
Well, Congressman, this is Maureen here, and I think we cannot underestimate how devastating losing you in the House of Representatives is, because back in the day when I was lobbying at National Right to Life, we had 99 Democrats who would vote against tax funding of abortion, for example, and many, many who would vote against late-term abortion. But now we're down to 3 Democratic members of Congress who will cast pro-life votes. And you, of course, were their leader, the leader of that small band of pro-life Democrats. So it's devastating to see you heading on to new adventures, but no doubt God has an amazing plan for your future. And later in the interview, we'd love to ask you about that. But tell us about your primary. And they came after you viciously. As you mentioned, they spent about $3 million against you, Planned Parenthood did, and the abortion lobby. So give us a little insight into that primary race.
Well, I was probably outspent about 3-1, which is remarkable for an incumbent to be outspent by that much. But this just showed how important it was for them to come after me. And it was a hard-fought race. I put more into this campaign than I think anything I've done in my life, because I thought it was that important. The primary happened a couple days before essentially the nation shut down, and it was on March 17th. I think that may have decreased the turnout amongst some of the older voters who were good voters for me in a Democratic primary. So I narrowly lost that, and it was tough to, take a defeat. But as I said, I had people immediately reach out to me and, thank me for what I had done, and thank me for not backing down. And I know in the end, that's what's most important. And I am confident that, God has a plan for me to do greater things after serving. So 16 years in Congress is a long time. I'm very happy with what I was able to do. But the day after election, I said that we move on from here and see what God has planned.
Well, the fact that you were so targeted because of your extremely courageous pro-life stance is absolutely a badge of honor. And let's talk about some of the issues that were a real priority for you in Congress. We know, of course, that the right to life issue was one of the preeminent issues that you worked on, but you also worked across the aisle on issues like international religious freedom. And I believe that in addition to helping to chair the pro-life caucus, you helped to chair the International Religious Freedom Caucus as well. Tell us a little bit about your work on that issue.
Yes, I'm co-chair of the International Religious Freedom Caucus because I know how critical that issue is. I've been attending the International Catholic Legislators Network annual meeting for most of the last 10 years since they've had it, and it's been a meeting that brings together Catholic legislators from around the world to talk about issues that are important everywhere in the world to Catholics, and one of those issues is religious freedom, and we see in many places around the world we see a lot of issues, and we hear a lot about the issues in the Middle East, and we also know that China serious problems in China with religious freedom. And this is something that we have to continue to, America needs to step up and needs to continue to speak out for the importance of religious freedom. I mean, it's something clearly important in our country. I have been very outspoken about religious freedom in our country also, because even though it's not the same drastic circumstances that we face in our country, I do have concerns in our country about losing our religious freedom. But, you know, in China, in many countries in the Middle East, it's a matter of life and death. So it's been very important for me. I think it's been the last 5 years I have been the co-chair of that caucus in the House.
Congressman, here in the United States, religious freedom is starting to seem a little bit life and death to us Americans who have been used to a lot of consideration for our consciences and our rights to exercise our religious freedom in the public square. And we are understandably feeling that these rights are becoming harder to exercise, that our options are becoming narrower. We had just now a recent defeat in the Supreme Court with a June medical case, Louisiana trying to put common sense regulations around abortion for women's safety. But you have shown through your work in Congress for so many years and the way that you've worked with so much integrity, even when you were swimming against the current of your own party when it comes to these important issues. What is it that gave you that kind of strength and that kind of determination to be that voice in the wilderness crying out for what's right?
Well, I can't rule out just being stubborn for one thing, but besides that, I just have always, well, I grew up in church at school. I went to Catholic school for 12 years, and also at home, I, you know, was taught the value of life, and that my responsibility, number one responsibility in life, is to live for Christ. And, you know, it's so easy, I think, for a lot of people when they get involved in politics. And, you know, it's a great way to be of service to others, is to be involved in government and in politics. But it sometimes, I think, for a lot of people, they become so wrapped up in that, and that becomes their self-worth, and they make a lot of compromises to what they believe so that they can, you know, gain power, to gain influence. And I knew that I was never going to do that. I knew that the issue, I remember, you know, when I first ran for Congress 16 years ago, I remember saying, you know, the one issue that I know I will never change on, no matter what happens, is I'm always going to be pro-life, and I'm going to be outspoken about being pro-life. And it, at the time, 16 years ago, it was a minority view inside the Democratic Party, but there were a lot of members who were pro-life. Even 10 years ago when we voted on the Affordable Care Act, the first time it went through the House, I think we had 64 Democrats who voted for the Stupak-Pitts Amendment that said no taxpayer funding for insurance that covered abortion. But it was something that I've always known. Look, I have to get up every day and look at myself in the mirror, and I understand that when I stand for judgment before the Lord, that I'm not going to be able to hide behind anyone or anything, and I have to really be able to account for, did I stand up for the most vulnerable in our society? And it's a challenge that for me and for everyone every day to continue to live up to that. And so, you know, that's what really has helped me to keep strong on this. And it helped to have other people who encouraged me. And you know, I think that's something important for all of us to remember, to encourage one another in our faith and in what we know to be true. Because as I said, it meant a lot to me, and people reached out to me afterwards. You know, I received a lot of calls. I received a call from Cardinal Dolan, received a call from from Carl Anderson, the Supreme Knight of Knights of Columbus, just thanking me for standing up for life. And we all have to remember to do that for each other and help each other. We're Catholics. We know this is we are in community, and we need to help support each other.
Well, your fortitude is so admirable. And, you know, we all face this in little ways in our life, but you face this in a really big way because your job, your entire career was on the line. And I guess I have two questions for you along those lines. One, I'm curious if you can share any anecdotes about any arm twisting. I mean, I'm just curious, how much pressure did you face within your own Democratic caucus? How much did they lean on you and twist your arm? And then secondly, how did you find that inspiration? I know you have a great devotion to St. John Paul II, and I'm just curious, how did you find that inspiration to have the fortitude that you have?
Well, in terms of the pressure, one thing, because I was so strong and showed that I would to my colleagues in my party that I was going to hold strong on the abortion issue, I didn't really have, after a while, people learned that I was not going to be an easy one to convince to change on the when there was a vote coming up. And so I was largely left alone. But, you know, it got to in 2018, I had a few of my colleagues here in the House endorse my primary opponent. This time I had even more. So it wasn't a matter of them coming up to me privately and saying something to me. It was very publicly coming out and saying, we want to get rid of you. I had five presidential candidates come out and support my opponent. And I'm sure the only thing they knew about me was that I was pro-life. But they had to signal to the rest of the party that how serious they were about being pro-choice. And they're going to oppose this horrible pro-life Democrat and rid the Democratic Party of anyone who is pro-life. So I certainly felt that more directly. I signed a discharge petition last year on the Born Alive Infant Protection Act, and I'll just say that I did that's one that I heard privately some complaints about me doing that, and I'll leave it at that for now. But I knew I was not going to change, and there's just something about watching other people through the years, other people who have changed their position, and just sort of imagining myself in their position and thinking I could not see that. And again, it comes down to what a person truly values internally. And that's where it comes from.
Congressman, I've been to a lot of different graduations, colleges, high schools, and I've heard all sorts of speeches, some of them better, some of them worse. But you recently gave a commencement speech, which was very beautiful, and it's on YouTube, and we'll post it to our podcast show notes so our listeners can watch it also. You gave a very beautiful commencement speech to a high school graduating class. And one of the lines that you said was, if you really want to change the world, you must choose to be Catholic and carry Jesus into the public square. That's a beautiful message, and I think your life exemplifies that. What were you trying to share with those graduates in that speech?
Well, I think in our society today, there is so much talk about division. We are two tribes, and they roughly equate to the two political parties. And I was saying that, look, to be truly Catholic, we don't fit completely comfortably in either party. And when it comes to politics, okay, you need to choose a party, but don't let partisanship become a religion for you. Remember, first and foremost, to be Catholic and to stand for those things that we as Catholics believe about the common good in what is true. And this is something that our world today, there's fewer and fewer people who understand the Catholic view of the world and of truth and what is good. A lot of people don't understand the way I have voted in Congress because they don't understand how someone could vote sometimes as a Democrat and sometimes they see as a Republican, and they're very confused by it. But I very much keep it in line, try to keep it in line with what I believe is, as a Catholic, what I should be doing. And my, my message to graduates is be Catholic, and first and foremost, be Catholic. And everyone leaving school, especially leaving college, talks about, you know, wanting to change the world. Well, that's the way to do it. Don't get swept up in some of what we see going on, especially what some of what we see going on right now in society. Don't be, you know, co-opted, coerced into doing things that are not true to our Catholic beliefs. What, if we really want to change the world, and as you mentioned earlier, St. John Paul II, who's, you know, truly to me as a Polish American, especially just his witness is just incredible. I think even more important today than when he was alive, because, you know, we have to have hope no matter how bad some things look right now. And he's truly an inspiration to me, a man who went through everything that he went through in his life, but he still always held firm to his faith. And so he always had hope. And that's important for all of us to remember. No matter how dark things may seem today, we know our hope is in Christ. And we know that we need to always have hope and not fall into despair.
Well, Congressman Lipinski, we're going to miss you very sorely in Congress and in our nation's capital, but I'm sure that wherever you go next, you will bring your beautiful soul to it and people will be the better for it. So thank you for joining us today on Conversations with Consequences.
Thank you. Thank you for having me.
Every morning, the Catholic Association reviews all the latest news and sends our subscribers a carefully curated collection of the most important news of the day. Items are specifically selected for a smart Catholic audience like you. Don't let the world take you by surprise. Subscribe to our daily media roundup at thecatholicassociation.org. And now, Father Roger Landry offers us, as is customary, a short and inspiring homily to prepare us for this Sunday's Gospel.
This is Father Roger Landry, and it's a privilege for me to be with you as we enter into the consequential conversation the risen Lord Jesus wants to have with each of us this Sunday. Jesus is going to give us one of the most incredible invitations we've ever received, and if we say yes to it, one of the most unbelievable guarantees. The God-man, our Savior, will say, "Come to me, all you labor and find life burdensome." That's the invitation. "Come to me, all you are working hard but can't seem to get your head above water. Come to me, all you are burdened with the anxieties of family life, work, age, or health. Come to me, all you are weighed down by sorrows, who are going through life with heavy heart because you've lost a loved one or are worried about the health of someone close to you. Come to me, all you are pressed down by your sins and the harm sins always bring to our lives and the lives of those around us. Come to me, all you are worried about your country on this Independence Day and its future direction. All of you, come." After this invitation, Jesus gives us an extraordinary promise, and I will refresh you. Think about what Jesus is saying. All of you who have problems with human life, all of you who are worried about the coronavirus, come to me and I'll renew you, bring you back to life, make you see the blessing in what you see as a burden. That's what he said to his listeners 2,000 years ago, who must have been shocked by so categorical a promise. That's what he says to each of us. Don't all of us need Jesus' help to bear heavy burdens? To understand better Jesus' amazing offer, we first have to look at whom Jesus is summoning and whom he isn't. Jesus addresses his invitation to those who labor and are carrying heavy burdens. He's not calling him to himself in this way those who are lazy, who pass the buck, who don't roll up their sleeves and work up a sweat. He's not inviting those who are seeking a comfortable, easy life. When Jesus says, "Follow me," he's not intending to lead us to a beach resort or a superyacht. He's going to lead us along the same path he trod, which was a hard-working path all the way to Calvary. Jesus is speaking rather to those who are already diligent, who are striving to take responsibility for their life, for the life of their loved ones, for society, for our nation, for the church, who are pushing themselves in love to the limit. Jesus had told us once to pray to the harvest master, his Father, to send laborers, not bodies, into his vineyard. The way to salvation and the salvation of others in that vineyard is through responding to all his gifts with faith, love, fatigue, and perspiration. It's those who labor, whom he promises to refresh. Second group of people whom Jesus is not calling are the proud, the arrogant, those who already think they know it all. Jesus tells us in the gospel this week, "And I give you praise, Father, Lord of heaven and earth, for although you have hidden these things from the wise and learned, you have revealed them to the little ones." Those who are wise and learned in their own eyes don't capture what Jesus is revealing or value his invitation because they don't think they need it. It's only the little ones, those who are humble, those who know how much they need the Lord, who know the worth of what Jesus wants to give. Jesus himself is meek and humble of heart, and in order to understand what he wants to reveal, we have to become meek and humble too. There are great consequences hanging on whether we do. Jesus said that in order to enter into his kingdom, in order to get to heaven, we have to become like little children. This isn't a call to be childish, but childlike, simple, trusting, and obedient, even if we're 95 years old. If we think we know it all, we really know very little, either about ourselves or about God's power and wisdom. The second thing we have to tackle is how Jesus promises to refresh us. He doesn't pledge to do so by taking away our burdens. That's what most of us think we want. If we're dealing with the stress and fatigue of life, most of us think we want the Lord to take away all our hardships so that we can live without stress, without money concerns, without anxieties over others, without the need to put in hardworking days. We want the Lord to exchange whatever difficulties we have for an easier, more comfortable, relaxing life. That's not what Jesus knows is best for us nor wants to do. Immediately after inviting us and promising us that he will refresh us, he gives his remedy. "Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I'm meek and humble of heart, and you'll find rest for yourself." To find a refreshment involves two things. First, coming to Jesus to learn. He is the master. He wants us to come to him directly and learn from him. That's why he has us come to Mass each Sunday, so that we can learn from him in sacred scripture and have him teach us from the inside through Holy Communion. It's also the reason why he wants us to pray each day, because in prayer he continues to whisper to us the path to humility and meekness. Second, we need to take Jesus' yoke upon our shoulders. We need to go in tandem with him through life. But what is his yoke? It's what he put on his shoulders, his cross. At first glance, it seems ridiculous that Jesus called the yoke of the cross easy and light. After all, he fell 3 times under its weight. Was the most difficult instrument of his painful crucifixion. What made him capable of calling it sweet and light, however, is the love with which he bore it. The cross is not so much a sign of pain and suffering, but of the love for the Father and for us that made that pain bearable. When the Lord says he wants us to learn from him in taking his yoke upon ourselves, he's telling us that we need to learn to take his love upon ourselves and bear our own crosses like he bore his. There's the great true story from Boys Town almost 100 years ago, when a crippled boy with leg braces had difficulty walking. Other orphans would take turns giving him a ride on their backs. A photographer saw the scene and snapped a photo that became famous. When the boy carrying his lame friend was asked whether his friend was heavy, he replied, "He ain't heavy, he's my brother." The love he had for his fellow orphan was so great that he was willing to bear the pain. That's what Jesus is talking about in the gospel. He's not asking us to do anything he himself hasn't already done for us. He, the good shepherd, bears each of us as lost sheep on his shoulders, and he doesn't complain about the weight, for to him we're not heavy, we're his beloved brothers and sisters. The more we love like him, the lighter and easier our burdens will be. And just like the best place for us to learn meekness and humility from Jesus at Mass and prayer, so the best place for us to be carried by him and strengthened to carry others is at Mass as well. Jesus says, "Come to me," and we carry each other as brothers and sisters to Christ at the altar. The Eucharist is the place where Jesus gives us himself within so that he might help us bear our burdens literally from within. The Eucharist is the summit of Jesus' meekness and humility, who loved us so much that he became our food under the appearances of bread and wine. The Eucharist is the place where simply Jesus refreshes us. He renews his invitation, "Come to me, all you who labor and find life burdensome, and I'll refresh you." And he's waiting for us this weekend to RSVP, to approach him with childlike humility, and to receive the amazing fulfillment of the promise he guarantees. God bless you all.
Thank you, Father Landry. To hear more from Father Landry, check out his website at catholicpreaching.com. And you can also catch his writings at EWTN's own National Catholic Register. A big thank you to all our listeners for joining us. I hope that this show was helpful. I hope that it gave you more peace and more hope and more joy. And you go with our prayers.